Good evening, everybody. I'd like to welcome you to the February meeting of the Brookfield Agricultural Commission. Our guest speaker this evening is Steve Gould, manager of the Hardwick Farmers Co-op. So without further ado, I'd like to turn it over to Steve.
How you doing? As Cindy said, my name's Steve Gould. I manage Hardwick Farmers Co-op. Before Hardwick Farmers Co-op, I grew up on a small dairy farm in Spencer, Mass. And went to Stockbridge School of Agriculture at the University of Massachusetts. And after Stockbridge, worked some dairies in Vermont, Dudley, Mass, and actually Elm Hill Farm here in Brookfield. I managed Elm Hill Farm until my boss John Spencer's health got to the point where they had to disperse the cattle. That was in 1990. At that point, I took the position at the co-op. I'm also the president of the Northeastern Poultry Congress, which is the Congress puts on the second or third largest poultry show in the country every January at the Big E Fairgrounds. And I'm on the Massachusetts Poultry Enhancement Council as a representative for the backyard poultrymen and exhibition poultry people. When I was a boy, I didn't have chickens. On the home farm, we didn't have chickens and didn't really have any knowledge about them or anything. When I went to UMass, there was I had a work study program. I graduated in animal science. Wanted to work in my major. Didn't have a car to get off the campus to go to the dairy farm, so I took a position at the poultry farm. Learned a lot in the 2 years that I worked there, and found out that I like chickens pretty well. As I said, after that, I dairied for a number of years. Again, didn't really have too much involvement with chickens, but then when I went to work for Hardwick Farmers, for the first few years I didn't really have any animals. And after growing up with animals all my life and working with animals all my life, I just felt that there was something missing in my life. Knew I didn't want to have dairy cows, so where I was having the milk every day, and knew the chickens were probably something that I might be interested in. Found out about the Boston Poultry Show that year, which was being held in Topsfield, Mass. And happened to be a national. There's two large clubs in the poultry world. The American Poultry Association, which is the oldest club in the country, and then the American Bantam Association. Not really sure who was sponsoring the national that year, but each year one of the club will sponsor a national in a different venue across the country. When they do that, a lot of people come in from all over the country to show their birds, and you see quite a few birds. There was probably 2,000 plus at that show that year. And so when I went to see what there was for poultry or whatever, there was a lot of different breeds to take a look at and see what I liked. The one breed that I was attracted to was a Dutch Bantam breed, which is a true Bantam, stays very small, and is a nice little bird to work with. I didn't buy any there, talked to some of the breeders, and found that the poultry people at the shows are just a really nice group of people, easy to talk to. They'll share a lot of information with you, and pretty warm group, and that's kind of when I decided that I was interested in possibly showing birds. Probably 2-3 weeks later, I went to the little roadie show, which is the Rhode Island State Poultry Show. Most of the New England states have their own shows, and at the little roadie show, I bought my first pair of birds and a couple of Dutch Bantams, and that was a start. Now I presently have a little over 50 birds, 30 Dutch Bantams, and 20 Golden Campines, which Golden Campines are a standard breed. They were developed in Belgium, and they're an egg layer. And when I say standard, Standard just means a large chicken. The bantam is your smaller chicken. In some cases, a bantam chicken is a small version of a large chicken, or it can be, like in the case of the Dutch, they're just a small bird. They're a true, what they call a true bantam. There's no large fowl that match up to the Dutch. The Dutch were developed in Holland. They've been around for centuries and used on the ships and things like that, just because they don't take up a lot of room. The sailors could have fresh eggs, fresh meat, and they were easy to keep. But they're a pretty small bird. They don't make, I think the males are about 6 ounces when they're full grown, so they're not real big. But actually maybe a little bit more than that, but they're pretty small. As far as it goes, I know a lot of people here have had poultry before, so some of this is going to be a rehash of what you know and things. I was going to go through a lot of the different things, and I'll go through it, but as I said, a lot of this may be repetition to what you guys already know. When you're buying, the first thing that you want to do is to decide what you're going to get for a breed. What you're going to do if you're looking for egg layers or if you're looking for meat birds. At that point, you can, or if you're looking for bantams, if you're looking for something for exhibitions. But most people are looking for either egg layers or meat birds to grow. When at that point, the best thing to do is to find out which breeds you want to go with. And there's a lot of different breeds. There's the purebred breeds that have been around, some of them the heritage breeds from this country. Most of them were developed actually in the New England area, or whatever, like the Plymouth Rock, the Rhode Island Red, that type of bird, the New Hampshire. Those breeds are great breeds, they do well. The older breeds, a lot of times they're dual purpose breeds. You can use them for eggs first and then meat later on and stuff. With those breeds, a lot of times you're gonna get an egg every other day. You don't usually get an egg a day. The production breeds now that are popular are crossbreds or hybrids. And those are the ones that you're gonna get an egg on a daily basis. Once you decide what you want for a breed, then you have to find them. And there's different ways to do that. You can order from a catalog or online. There's a lot of different hatcheries that are across the country that will sell to you. When they do that, a lot of them have a minimum that they'll sell to you. Usually it's 15 or 25 birds. You can have the birds sexed, where they'll guarantee usually about 90% of the birds are going to be, if you're having sex for females, usually if you're buying layers, obviously, you're going to have the females and stuff. 15 to 25 birds is a lot of birds for a lot of people. I mean, that's gonna give you an awful lot of eggs. Most small families can get away with 6 or 8 birds easily, and that's still gonna give you a lot of eggs over, especially if you get a production bird that you're getting close to an egg a day from. Another good way to do it is to purchase it through a farm and home store. There's a lot of farm and home stores around here that sell chicks, and the minimum in the state of Massachusetts is 6. You have to buy 6 chicks. Mainly that's an old blue law. It's been on the books well over 100 years. It's because chickens are a flocking breed, they need other chickens around to really be happy and just to do well. So someone made the law years ago that it's 6 chicks to get. But a lot of times different farm and home stores will allow you to mix that if you want to mix up breeds. Sometimes that's good, sometimes that's bad. Chickens are actually prejudiced, so I mean, if you mix them up and you raise them from chicks, they usually do really well. If you have them at a later age and you put different colored birds with different colored birds, they don't usually mix very well. But that's a way that you can buy them at the Farm and Home store. It's a good way to do it because then you can usually see your birds, you can pick out what you want, and it's that way you know that your birds are going to be healthy right from the start. Not taking away from what the birds that are being mailed through the post office, but sometimes if they're handled, if they're shipped, and it's been really cool or whatever, and they set the boxes up to be shipped in cool weather, and all of a sudden you get a really hot night, sometimes the chicks will be stressed, you'll get them, and some of them will be gone or going, and that's not real well. But for the most part, that doesn't happen too often, but it can happen as far as if there's a temperature change when they're shipping them. Another possibility is buying from a breeder. And from a breeder, you can get different breeds depending on what the breeder's raising. Sometimes you may not be able to find the breeds that you might see that you'd like to get and that would be close. And a breeder, for the most part, is going to sell, they're going to sell birds that are pretty much full grown or almost full grown. A lot of times occasionally you get a breeder that will sell chicks, but most of the time they're looking to sell adult birds. And the reason for that is that if they're raising the birds, if they're selling chicks, they don't know if the chick that they're selling you could be the best bird that they've hatched that year. So they usually let them grow up where they can pick out the best ones that they want for their breeding program. And then the other birds that are really good quality in most situations or whatever, they sell those birds off for people that are interested in them. So that's another way to get it. Once you get your chicks home, the first thing you want to do, especially if they're from a Farm and Home store or they're sent through the mail, they haven't had feed or water in most cases. So you want to make, you can do it in a big box. You set up a brooder depending on how many chicks you have. You don't want to give them a lot of room where they can get out and get cold, and you want to keep it fairly tight depending on the amount of chicks that you have. If you have a small amount, one light works well. And you don't need a big brooder. If you have maybe a 2x2 to start out with, works out pretty well. If you have a large amount, 100 chicks or something like that, you may want to have probably like a 4x8 or 4x6 for it. You don't really need huge to start out with because they're pretty small to go with. The chicks, a lot of times the best way to start them is on newspaper. I find that if you put them on that to start with, it tends to be pretty decent. Something that I like to do is to take paper towels and put it down on the newspaper for the first couple days. Sometimes the newspaper, you want to use the regular newspaper, not the shiny newspaper anyways, but even the regular newspaper can be slippery for them. And those first couple days, their legs aren't real strong. A lot of times they can slip and have problems with their legs. So if you put down some paper towels, it gives them something to grab a hold of and things. And within a couple of days, you can pretty much pull the paper towels and then they'll be on the newspaper. The newspaper works well. It's easy to keep clean. You can take the paper out quickly, change it with new newspaper. One thing sometimes that I'll do is I'll put down extra amount, probably 8 or 10 layers or whatever, and then I can pull a couple layers off and have fresh there. Usually after the first week, you can start to use shavings. Why you don't use shavings at the very beginning is a lot of times they don't know what food is at that point. They're going out and they're pecking at it and stuff. If they get shavings, they can actually eat it, and then that'll kind of impact their intestines, and then you'll lose them shortly after. So you want them those first couple of days just to have the food and water. Simple things. This is a little water fountain. It just, ball mason jar of base works out really well. You put this down, and when you first put your chicks in, sometimes they're not used to it. If you just take them and put their beaks into the water, they'll usually figure it out really fast. As soon as they have some water on their beaks, they pick it up and go with it. The feeders, for the first couple of days, you may actually want just a feed pan versus having a feeder like this. They will do all right with this, but sometimes just having feed in a little pan where they can get to it easily gets them started, where they realize what it is and they go for it pretty well. The heat lamp, I always recommend usually the red heat lamp, and that's it's an infrared lamp. Seems to be better for the birds. I don't really know the scientific reason why it is, but it definitely is, as far as they seem calmer with it. They do a lot better. If the chicks, sometimes they'll get wet from the water, this dries them up really fast. They always do better with a red lamp. Rule of thumb that works really well is if you go about 18 inches off the base of the brooder, that's a good rule of thumb to start with. And when you're looking at the chicks, if you watch your chicks in that first couple hours, if they're all bunched up under that light, they're cold, and you need to drop your lamp down a little bit. If they're trying to get away, if they're on the outskirts of the brooder and they're trying to get away from the lamp, then it's too hot and you want to raise it up a little bit. What you want to see is those birds actually just active, going around, they're eating, they're sleeping, they're just around acting like normal chickens. And that works pretty well as far as that goes. First week is crucial to have your heat lamp at a good site, good height, keeping it warm. You want your brooder draft free. You don't want any cool air to be able to come in from the sides in the beginning. So, and that first week is real critical as far as keeping them warm, keeping them going. Once they get through that, then they're a lot easier to take care of after that. You'll start to see feathers forming on the chicks within a couple days of having them at the house. You'll see some feathers form at the tips of their wings. You'll see some at the tail, and it's what you're looking for is for that chick to feather out completely. If you get chicks in April, February, even March, those areas or whatever, those are your cooler temperatures. You're probably going to have a heat lamp over your chicks in a situation like that for about 3 months. If you're getting chicks closer to the summer, end of May, June, July, then you're probably only going to have a heat lamp over them about 2 months, and they'll be able to take it. When you start to take the heat lamp away from them, you don't want to just take it away cold turkey. You want to actually, as you start to do it, raise it up a couple of inches for a couple of days, let them get adjusted to that, and then raise it up to a couple more inches. And they do really well with that as far as they come along, and they'll feather out. Sometimes as they grow, you may have to get your brooder a little bit larger, give them a little extra room. Chickens need some room to move around, and if they're bunched up too much, you can start running into problems and things. They just get nervous, and sometimes they go after each other and things. So you want to give them room. And that's after, once you have them out of the brooder, then you're going into a coop. And your coop can be as fancy or as basic as you want it to be. The main thing with the coops is that Again, it's pretty well draft free, that they're fairly tight for drafts, but on the other side of it, you want good ventilation. You want fresh air to be able to move through it and things. You want the birds to be able to get into their coop, to be dry, to be protected from predators, to keep their bedding clean, and just where they can get out of the weather and stuff and be safe. Once in a very short time, they get used to their coop, and that's where they want to be, especially at night times. You want to give your birds a perch. They usually chickens perch where they get up onto usually some high point, usually a rail. Especially with New England, you want to put a perch where birds can get together on it and stay warm during the winter. A lot of people believe that they have to put substitute heat into a chicken coop in the wintertime. Chickens can take a lot. They can take some really cold temperatures. They don't really need a heat lamp or any type of heater unless you probably are below zero for a week at a time, and that doesn't happen here in New England too much anymore. So. But as far as if you have four birds, six birds, or more, then they're going to get together in the really cold weather and keep each other warm and bunch up. So you really don't need a heat lamp. I do have a heated barn at my house, but I usually keep that between 35 and 40 degrees. And that's just because I have single comb birds, which means they have the one comb on the tops of their heads that pretty much like the Kellogg's rooster, I guess is the best way to describe it. And those combs you can get frostbite on them. And the judges, if you have frostbite on your combs, they don't treat you well with that. They don't want to see that. So I do keep one barn heated where I keep my males and my bams and things. So. But again, I don't keep it at 70 or anything like that. It's 35 to 40 degrees. It wasn't on today. I actually have it on a timer on the colder days where it shuts off for hours during the daylight, and then it comes back on at night when the cooler temperatures are coming through. But if you've got production birds, you don't really need to do that. Keeping your litter really clean is a good practice. You want to you don't want to get to the point that you go into your coop and you get an ammonia smell. Usually if you're smelling ammonia, it's probably 100 times worse for the birds. It's too intense, and that's a lot of people will put they'll have their litter. After a week or so, they'll go in and they'll put fresh litter on that and stuff, and they'll do that repeatedly. If you're not dealing with a lot of birds and things, that works out really well as far as you can keep it pretty clean, you can keep the ammonia down. If you're dealing with a lot of birds or you're in a really small area, that can get pretty potent. After probably once a month or something like that, you want to take that litter out and put fresh litter in. If you do that, you run a lot less risk of having problems having any disease issues or anything like that. If your birds are clean and they're dry, they'll do a lot better for you. Coops can have runs on them, or you can have chicken tractors, which are basically movable runs that you put birds into, and you can move them on a day-to-day basis onto fresh grass or whatever. Birds like to forage. They're going after the bugs, the worms, the grasses and weeds and things like that. And they'll usually go at all sorts of things with that. Or you can have an attached run, which after a while usually gets pretty worked down. But just getting the birds out in the sunlight and having just in the dew with a little bit of rain or whatever, you'll see a bird that goes outside looks so much better than a bird that's kept inside on a day-to-day basis. They're a lot healthier, they do a lot better, they stay a lot better. Some people will actually free range their birds. I'm not a big fan of free ranging. I think in most cases when you hear people that are free ranging their birds, they may have them for a couple of, they might do well for a couple of weeks, maybe even a couple of years or whatever with not having any problems. But when you're free ranging, especially here in New England, there's so many predators that we have that you're just pretty much guaranteeing that you're gonna lose some birds eventually, either by hawks or skunks actually do more damage than people realize. Raccoons are noted chicken killers, and fisher cats, foxes, bobcats become pretty crazy lately and stuff. So, but you wanna, if you can give them some protection, it's a lot better. Even that doesn't guarantee you that you're gonna have perfect luck or whatever. Sometimes, even with my outside pens, somehow they get a bird to come to the fence or whatever, and usually a fox or a raccoon at that point will take the head right off the bird at that point. They can't usually get it out of the pen at that point, but when you go to put the birds away at night or something, you could find a headless carcass in your pen, which isn't real pleasant, but for the most part, it protects them and gives them a lot of security, but still gets them where they can be outside and enjoy it. Water is super important. You want to make sure that you've got fresh water. Usually once a day, I feel you should change your water. Some people will keep it a little bit longer, but fresh water really is key to healthy birds and keeping them going. I actually change my water twice a day, but I've got small pens that I'm working with and stuff versus huge amounts of birds. The feeds, when you start with the chicks, your first feeds are starter feeds. Those are usually going to be in a crumble or a mash form. It's going to be easy for the chicks to eat, and it goes with that. There's different schools on it. It's 8 to 10 weeks that you're going to have them on starter. I usually like to keep them on 10 weeks and sometimes longer on the starter, just because of the protein and just having a little bit more fortified feed form for a little bit longer. Once you go from the starter, then you go into a grower, and the grower you're going to feed until, if you're dealing with layers, and that's where you feed the grower, you're going to feed that until they start to lay. And you don't want to really start the layer feed, which usually comes in a pellet, a crumble, or a mash. Grower is usually a crumble or a pellet. You don't really want to start the layer feed early, because what happens is the layer feed has a high calcium rate in it, and that's because the birds are utilizing the calcium for their eggs, and they need the extra calcium. If you start that with a younger bird that isn't really calling for that calcium levels and stuff, it can build up in their bodies and they can start to have issues with it. So you have to be careful with starting a layer feed before they really start to lay. The other feed that's out there is broiler feed, and that's for the meat birds. You can start meat birds with a starter feed, which some people do, and have pretty good luck. The feed companies actually recommend going with a straight broiler and just going with start to finish, basically from the starting. Most of the broilers are in crumbles or a small pellet, and going right until you process the birds. A lot of your meat birds, I didn't really go over many of the meat birds. There's the Cornish Rock, which is a crossbred between a Cornish and a Plymouth Rock. Those birds will grow in like 8 weeks time. They're really fast growers, really And that's basically from hatching to 8 weeks, they're ready for, you're gonna get a broiler chicken that's gonna be probably anywhere from 4 to 6 pounds. And they're basically little eating machines when it comes to that. Another meat bird, there's one called the Red Ranger, which has become popular recently. They were developed in France. They're really good meat birds as far as they put on. They don't necessarily put on a large breast like the Cornish Rocks, but they put on large legs, and through the body and stuff, they'll grow up pretty well. They're slower growing, but they act more like chickens as far as you can actually forage the Red Rangers, hence the name, so that they don't require quite as much feed as the Cornish. You still want to give them feed. I know people that have just tried to forage them, and that's what they're processing them after 10 to 12 weeks. They do take a little bit longer, and they're not getting too much there. I think if you're doing a program where you're foraging them plus you're giving them broiler feed, you're going to do a lot better, and you're going to be able to get that bird up to a lot better size where you can process it. Some people will feed broiler start to finish, and then there's other people that last week that the broilers are, before they're processed, they'll go with a finisher feed, which is a higher energy feed. A lot of times corn-based, it's just gonna put a little bit, what they call a finish on them or whatever, a little bit more fat, just to make them a little tastier. Some people do that. It's not so much anymore as it used to be, but that's something that you can do. As far as diseases that you have to worry about, there's diseases out there. Probably the one you have to worry about the most is coccidiosis. And coccidiosis is a parasite that attaches itself to the intestinal lining. And in chicks that are anywhere from a week to a month and a half, you have to watch it very closely, because what you'll see is all of a sudden there'll be blood in their stools, and you'll see the chicks, they've dropped their wings where they're dragging their wings on the ground. They've usually got their head down. They're not eating, they're not drinking. Within 24 hours of getting coccidiosis, you can lose them. There's actually in the grower feed, or not the grower feed, the starter feed, you can get a medicated feed, which has a product called Amprolium in it. And Amprolium is a coccidiostat. It's a medicated feed. Some people get nervous with that. Amprolium has been used in feed for many, many years. And it's been proven very, very safe. And it basically will stop the chicks from getting coccidiosis. One thing that's a little bit misleading with coccidiosis is that you can get it in other times of the year, but most of the time, the coccidiosis shows up when you're dealing in really hot, muggy temperatures. Later in the year, if you're getting your chicks in like June or so, June, July, you've got to watch out for coccidiosis. And coccidiosis is, during the other parts of the year, usually if you get your chicks early in the season, you don't really have to worry about coccidiosis. Once in a great while, you might get it. If you're not feeding medicated feed and you start to see coccidiosis, it's not something to worry about very much. You can buy a liquid Amprolium. The product that you see more often than not is a product called Cord. You put a little cord into their water. If they have a few drops of that, if you've got chicks that are their wings are hanging, their heads are down or whatever, and you've got cord in the water, and you just put their beaks in and get them to drink a couple of swallows, within a couple of hours, they're usually back and doing well. Coccidiosis is in, it's in the environment most of the time. Once chickens get beyond that month and a half period or whatever, they can handle it and they fight it off and it works out pretty well. Another disease that shows up once in a while is a disease called Merrick's. And Merrick's is, you can pretty much, with Merrick's, they lose the use of their leg or legs. It can be one leg, all of a sudden you'll see a bird that they just don't have control over a leg. And usually they go down, they can't really stand up. With Merrick's, it's a slow disease. A lot of times they want to live. I mean, they'll fight. If you get them food and water where they can reach it and stuff, they'll last a couple of months, and then after a while they just kind of lose the will to live because they know they can't get up, and you end up losing them. Merrick's is known to be untreatable, and you don't see it often. I probably see it every 2 to 3 years, and usually it affects one bird in the flock, and that's about it. They do vaccinate chicks for Merrick's. You can pay a small fee through the hatcheries and get them to vaccinate the chicks. And actually, it's a spray that they put over the box when there's a do it. I think that's kind of touch and go how it works, but for the most part, you don't see a lot of it, of Merrick's. Something that I've been fooling with for a little bit is, I read it online, there's a product called colloidal silver, which is, it's used, you find it in health food stores, it's, people use it for general health and things. I'm not even sure quite what it does for people or whatever, but if you take colloidal silver and you actually give it to the birds on a daily basis, the last bird I had with Merrick's, which was over 2 years ago now, she regained the use of her legs. Not 100%, she still had problems walking, and you could tell that she was stiff-legged and things, but she was able to, she lasted another 2 years, and I gave her the colloidal silver for about 2 months straight, and then stopped at that point. And she died at a fairly young age, but I think she was maybe 3.5, 4 or whatever. But that was the only bird that I've ever really done, and haven't really tried it on anybody since. I haven't had any situations with it. I should knock on wood when I say that, but that's something that if you get into a situation where you're fighting Merrick's, it might be something to try. Can't guarantee it, but it's something that I'm seeing a little bit of results on. There's other diseases as far as respiratory diseases. Sometimes you'll hear chickens sneezing and things. With that, there's a bunch of different ones. Some of them, for the most part, if you hear them sneezing, if you get a stress pack, a vitamin mineral pack, which is a water-soluble vitamin or whatever, and you put that into their water, and you want to do it for the whole flock. If you've got one bird doing it, you want to pretty much give it to the whole flock, because some of the respiratory diseases especially can be pretty, they can transfer it to the other birds and stuff. You used to be able to use an antibiotic in really bad cases. Unfortunately, there was a new law that just started the first of this year that all water-soluble antibiotics have been taken off the market. You have to have a prescription to get those now. And it's a little unfortunate that they've done that, but there is some products that are being developed, I'm hearing, and I'm hoping to see some of those at some upcoming buying shows that are coming up in the next month. There's some deadly diseases like avian influenza, which I'm sure everybody's heard about, and we haven't seen it in this area for many years. It's one that they watch very closely because that it's one of the few diseases that can actually, it can mutate into where it's, that humans can get it from and stuff. Right now, it's not in this country. It doesn't survive heat, actually. If you have 3 days over 90 degrees, it kills avian influenza. And that's pretty much how we lost it in this country, where it started to show up a couple years ago. But it's not something that you see on a regular basis. It's not something that I've ever seen in this area, and I hope I never do. But a lot of times with birds like that, what happens is the FDA comes in and actually depopulates the whole flock. They'll actually kill them off, and they compost those birds so that there's no chance of anybody catching the disease or mutating and stuff. As I said, hopefully we never see anything like that. There's some other diseases that you can get from wild birds and things. Mostly they start as respiratory. A lot of times, if you can keep your coops fairly tight with using smaller wire or whatever so that wild birds can't mix in with them, you're giving yourself a little bit of an insurance policy that you'll be away from that. As far as with that, pests too, there's, with pests, chickens can get worms, especially when they're outside and on the ground and stuff. The most common worm that chickens get is roundworm. Roundworm is real prevalent through the soils and stuff. Earthworms usually have roundworms, and if a chicken eats an earthworm, chances are they'll have roundworms after that and things. Really easy to treat. There's a product called piperazine or wazine. Again, it's something that you add to the water. Doesn't actually kill the roundworms. It works as, what it does is it paralyzes them so that they can't hold on to the intestinal lining. And then the bird, as they pass their urine and feces or whatever, they're passing the worms over too. And then usually the sun kills the roundworms that are paralyzed there. So it's, that one, it works real well. Usually a good practice is to worm your chickens once a year, just to put some in, and it's very, very simple. You just put a little wazine or piperazine. Wazine is actually a brand name. Piperazine is actually the active ingredient. And if you put that into the water, that takes care of it. There are other worms that chickens get, but for the most part, roundworms are the main ones that you have to worry about. If you start having real problems where they're not holding weight, their feathers aren't real lustrous, if you're not seeing a shine in the feather or something like that, they look kind of ragged, a lot of times that's a good indication that you're dealing with some worms. And if you try the piperazine and things, that works well. There's other wormers out there like Ivomec, which really aren't labeled for poultry, but a lot of poultry people use it. That one's pretty dicey. It's not one that I'd recommend. You can actually kill your birds pretty easily with it, but that one also takes care of other pests and stuff too. Two pests that chickens get, and especially once you have chickens, usually you're going to have, at one point or another, you probably have one or both. One is lice, and lice are basically blood suckers that go onto the birds. They usually go into the feathers, and they can strip a bird down pretty well and things. And it's usually, you can see the lice very easily. You can control it with a permethrin spray or a permethrin dust. Another dust that works very well is 7-Dust that you can put on the birds, and that works well. The sprays, if you're in warmer temperatures, when you're in the summertime or whatever, they're really the most effective because they're going to get into the best thing. But during the winter times, a lot of times with the cold, you don't want to spray the birds down, get them wet, get them cold. So you you go with the dust. And lice are bad. Probably the worst one is mites. There's on the mites, you're dealing with feather mites, which go into the feathers. You're dealing with leg mites that actually go underneath the scales on the legs or whatever. Really painful with that for the birds. And then you're also dealing just with there's a red or a black mite, black poultry mite that they can get, which that's just going usually around their whole body, and it's sucking the blood out of the birds. They're very tiny. They're almost microscopic in some cases. And the best way to see if you have mites is right about dusk. If you turn the bird over, you look around the vent area, you'll see some movement sometimes, as far as the mites don't really like light, so they tend to move at that point, and you'll see movement around the vent, so you can tell that you have mites. Again, the permethrin spray or dust or the 7 are the best way to go on that. If the mites are there for a while and they can really they really can populate and end up, I've seen birds killed by mites, a really bad mite infestation. They'll suck the blood from the birds, but you can control it pretty easy if you're watching it. Again, it's mostly wild birds that bring those into your flock, or if you're bringing in other birds from other flocks or something. So, and that's pretty much all I have. And if you guys have any questions or...
How long has the Hardwick Farmers Co-op been in existence?
It started in 1914, so it's been 103 years this year. So it was started by 12 farmers looking to improve their buying power and actually to help sell some of their products and things.
They actually buy the farm there?
As far as the farmers got together, it used to be in the Page, at the Page Foundation, or the Page Building years ago, and now in the 70s, late 70s, they moved to its present spot in Gilbertville. Right now there's a little over 2,700 members of the co-op, and it's, back then it used to buy some of their produce. I mean, we still buy from some of the local people for some of their products, but and a lot of it was just, it gave them more buying power to buy in their feed, their fertilizers, their seed. They could buy more of it, and it's worked out pretty well over the years. There's been a lot of different changes with it, and it's a pretty good company. So.
Steve, all the products that you mentioned, you care for chickens, you have at Hardwick?
Yep, at Hardwick Farmers we have a lot of the products that I mentioned, actually all the products that I mentioned, and if we don't have it, we may be able to get it for you. So.
Thank you, Steve.
Thank you very much for listening to what I had to say. Hopefully.
It's so interesting that in Brookfield, just Brookfield, lately, we've had so much people asking about how to raise chickens and stuff, but
yep.
They have to come to the Zoning Board of Appeals because if they're not 5 acres, they can't have a farm. They don't understand that.
Yeah.
So we have three guys now. They're all trying to buy land, and I'm going, you have to have it all in one place.
And I mean, with a lot of times, like with the bantams, I mean, that's, if someone has a small area and doesn't have a large space, the bantams are a good way to go to raise, to have a few birds and things. But a lot of times, it's up to the towns for what they have for. A lot of times, there's bylaws in the towns on whether they can have poultry at their spots and things. Some towns don't allow any poultry. There's some towns that will allow hens but not roosters. It's pretty much worth checking with your town to see if what they require for it. But again, a few birds don't take a real lot of room, so you can make out pretty well. So they take out a lot less room than what a cow is going to take or a horse is going to take, and that's, people can have a few birds. We've seen there's been a huge amount of people that have started with poultry in the last probably 10 years. It's amazing how many people have poultry. Horse feed for us at Hardwick Farmers is still the number one seller, but number two, and not very far away from it, is poultry. And we sell a lot of bags of poultry feed. There's just in layer feed a month, I think we have about 8 different types, but we're probably selling about 800 to 900 bags of that a month of layer feed. So, and we're only one store. There's a lot of stores and stuff. And it's chicks we're selling. I think last year we sold about 3,800 chicks, and we sold over 1,000 turkey poults, young turkeys, and those people are buying the equipment, they're buying the feed. It's pretty amazing how much is out there, and a lot of people just have a few birds and they enjoy them. It's just watching them and getting to know how to take care of them and things. Chickens are easy. They don't take a long time to take care of. You can feed chickens in a couple of minutes and give them some fresh water and stuff. It's unless you have a lot of pens like I do, which is, and I've got friends that spend hours feeding their birds and stuff, but it's pretty easy backyard animal to have. It also is great. They're great for kids. Can teach kids responsibility at home and taking care of the animals and stuff. It's just, we have the poultry congress that I'm involved with, the show that's put on. We have anywhere from 60 to 70 kids taking part in that show every year. And they have the junior show, which is usually anywhere from 400 to 500 birds that are showing just in the junior side. And then there's all kinds of things for the kids as far as it goes, and those kids are into it. I mean, it's pretty great to see it, especially nowadays where so many kids are looking at their computer screens or their cell phones and things. I mean, these kids are focused and they've got their birds. You've got kids walking around with chickens all over the place, and there's all kinds of things happening with that. So, and then the friends that they meet and get to know. And the nice thing about poultry versus a lot of other things that people are involved in today is that, most of the animals and things, I mean, 4-H is great, but a lot of times with 4-H, you've got the kids are doing the projects, which is good. The parents are there, and they're usually watching over the kids and things. But with chickens, you can have kids with poultry, with chickens, and then their parents can have chickens too. I've seen families for years. You see fathers and daughters, fathers and sons, mothers and daughters, mothers and sons coming in, and mom's got the birds, and in some cases mom, dad, and all the kids have their birds, and they all have different breeds, and they're all showing together and stuff, and they're all competing, and just keeps people interested. I've seen parents that started out with their kids showing and gotten in, their kids were the ones showing at first, and then they got into it, and then their kids are off to college and getting married and starting their own families, and mom and dad are still showing the stuff. They're still at the shows and things because they've had such a good time with it. So
you have quite an assortment of books there. Can you recommend a basic library for people starting out with chickens?
I can. This one right here, this is Story's Guide to Raising Chickens. Gail Damoreau who, she's actually from Maine. She did this book many years ago. It's been updated. This is a new edition, and I think this is probably the, it doesn't say right on it what it is, but it's probably the 10th edition. This book is the Bible. I've got this book at home. It's got everything in it. It's amazing what these books carry. Story does a series. I mean, this is just about chickens, and it goes into meat birds, it goes into egg layers, it goes into incubation, it goes into all sorts of different things. They also do another one called Raising Poultry, and this one takes into not only chickens, but it's got turkeys, ducks, geese, guineas, game birds. They're all different ones like that. But these, the story books, they have an excellent information. I mean, I have this, and I go to it quite often for different things. It's got some great information into it. Another book that they're involved in, that they actually, Gail wrote this one too, it's called The Chicken Health Handbook. And that's just got some more information on some of the diseases, some of the pests, and things like that. And again, this one, this is the second edition of this, that this one's come out. And I don't have this one, but this one's really good. But usually this one, for most people, can cover everything. So, but that's, I can highly recommend that book. That's a great book to have.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.